On Nationwide this evening, it's Science Week, and we meet people who are exploring the heavens in search of new stars. Also, we meet the scientists who are daring to see faraway stars that no human has seen before. Good evening, welcome to Nationwide, welcome to Blackrock in Cork City. This is Science Week, and this evening we're all about science. Blackrock Castle was originally built as a lookout station for pirates and other ships coming into Cork Harbour. This castle on the River Lee has been here for as long as anyone can remember, and today it's a science centre and is home to Cosmos at the Castle, an award-winning interactive astronomy exhibition. Families come here to visit the castle and to learn about the cosmos. Not open to the public is the upstairs section, where we find a working professional astronomical observatory staffed by researchers from Cork Institute of Technology. They're engaged in searching for new planets around distant stars using telescopes. This evening we're going to be doing some stargazing, and we begin with a long journey to the European Southern Observatory, which ironically is based in Chile in South America. Will Goodbody has been there to see the ongoing work.
It's known for many things, including its capital, Santiago, its extreme landscapes, and a turbulent political past. But among astronomers, Chile means just one thing. Because the north of the country, which is partly covered by the Atacama Desert, has exceptionally clear and dark skies, offering stunning views of the centre of our Milky Way galaxy and the two dwarf galaxies, the Magellanic Clouds. And so the European Southern Observatory, or ESO, Europe's foremost intergovernmental astronomy research organisation, has built a number of observatories there.
We operate four observatory sites in Chile, which have been added over the 50-year history of ESO step by step. Okay, the first one is called La Silla, founded almost 50 years ago. And the second one in time is Paranal Observatory, where we are standing here, and we call this our flagship. Then we have a couple of newer telescopes, which are radio telescopes, observing radio waves. And then our facility number 5, which is not yet existing, but it is basically under construction, is the extremely large telescope, which will be finished hopefully by 2024, and will by then be by far the largest optical telescope on Earth.
Paranal is home to two telescopes for surveying and mapping the sky, as well as the appropriately named Very Large Telescope, or VLT. It's actually made up of four huge 8.2-metre-wide optical telescopes and another four 1.8-metre-wide auxiliary telescopes. They can operate independently, or the light they gather can be joined together using an interferometer to form one massively powerful eye on the sky.
In our solar system, there's something like there are eight planets, plus Pluto, a dwarf planet, but obviously in other solar systems, in other orbiting other stars, there are other planets. What we do, we look at the star, we occult the light from the star, we block it out, and when we block out that light, we can see tiny specks of light, and these tiny specks of light are extrasolar planets. We also can determine what the atmospheres of these planets are like. And in the future, in a not so distant future, the idea will be look for things like ozone and signs of life on extrasolar planets.
Paranal is like an oasis of science deep in the Atacama Desert, a self-contained working village with its own residence where the astronomers and technical staff sleep and eat when they are on site, and which featured in the James Bond movie Quantum of Solace. There's also a gym, workshops, power plant and more. It operates around the clock, with maintenance carried out during the day while the astronomers sleep, and stargazing at night when they are awake.
At the moment, I'm currently working a full night shift. So my day starts around maybe 5 p.m. I come up to the telescope for sunset around 6:30, start working and go all the way through until 5 a.m., 6 a.m. in the morning. Head straight back down and then do it all again the next day.
We discuss, we analyze how the night is, because every night is different, how the conditions are, and we decide on a program that we want to do, a special type of observation. And then we start moving the telescope to the desired position and start taking data.
While the VLT is big, not far from Paranal, ESO is planning something even bigger. At the top of this mountain, the European Extremely Large Telescope will soon be built. With a mirror the size of half a soccer pitch, it will be the largest optical telescope in the world.
Here we are driving up to the Chaknandor Plateau. This is the site of Yalma Large Millimeter Array. This is the place where the antennas are.
Much further inland from Paranal is the ALMA Observatory. Situated at a dangerously high altitude of 5,000 metres on a plateau high in the Andes, it is an array of radio telescopes, 66 very large mobile dishes which can collect light coming from some of the coldest parts of the universe. The environment is exceptionally harsh. Workers must often use supplementary oxygen, while without protection, skin burns in minutes. So most of the work is done from the support building further down the mountain.
It takes about 3/4 of an hour to travel from here to the high site, to the 5,000 meter site. It's a dirt road and it's often, we have problems with winds and things like that. So it's a challenging site. It's challenging also because it's of course very cold at altitude. We have two large vehicles which can lift the antennas up and transport them from one place to another. We have just under 200 different antenna stations dotted over the plain, on the Atacama Plain, and we can put an antenna down on any one of those 200 stations.
The location was chosen because water vapor distorts light signals, and this is among the driest places on the planet.
They are extremely good for basically looking at things that are forming, like galaxies forming, planets forming, stars forming. So millimeter wavelengths see through all the dust that obscures the optical and infrared, and you can see right to the core, and you can see, you know, what's happening right at the center of these dark clouds. So it's extremely powerful in that respect.
Right now, Ireland isn't one of the 15 European states, plus Chile, that are members of ESO. The government is currently considering joining, which would cost €14 million, plus an annual fee of €2 million. But astronomers here say it would be worth every cent.
I would be optimistic that it will happen eventually. Ireland is almost unique within Europe at the moment as not having access to the European Southern Observatory. And because of that, it excludes us from carrying out frontline astronomical research. And also it excludes Irish companies from bidding for European Southern Observatory contracts.
While those talks continue, though, so will the discoveries at ESO's facilities in Chile. As astronomers deepen our knowledge about stars, galaxies, exoplanets, black holes and more, and attempt to answer some of the most fundamental questions about the universe and our tiny place in it.
Fascinating work there in Chile, and of course back here in Cork at the Blackrock Observatory, everybody is hoping that Ireland will be able to join the European project and that Irish astronomers will be able to travel, work and learn there. Of course, you don't have to be a scientist to have an interest in the stars. There are many Irish who are followers of amateur astronomy. We've been to Mayo to meet a man who spends a lot of his spare time staring at the heavens, but who is particularly captivated by the Northern Lights.
A chance glance at the night sky that started a limitless adventure. Since Brian Wilson saw the Northern Lights from outside his home in Glengad, he's been enchanted by the beauty and mystique of this aerial phenomenon.
I knew that there was no moon, and I knew that it was in the depths of winter, and I was like, why is it so bright? Like, why can I see the silhouettes of clouds and things? And I said, oh my God, this couldn't be, could it? And I went outside and stood for a couple of minutes, and suddenly there was a big beam of light came up across the horizon and went right up into the sky and sort of faded down again and moved slowly across. And I went, oh my God, this is Northern Lights. Grab my camera.
The North Mayo photographer started taking pictures just 6 years ago. What began as a pastime soon developed into a passion.
Photography is one of these pastimes where as you get into it more, you'll actually start to see more things. So it's like as if the scales are kind of cleared from your eyes, in that you'll see more colours, you'll see light in a way that you've never seen it before. And so from that I progressed to a point where always at the back of my head was this notion of the night sky and wondering, wow, I wonder could I actually try and photograph that.
The task is made easier by geographic location. Around here, the sky looms large.
People in the city, when you ask them where's the sky or ask them to point to the sky, they'll point up. But here in North Mayo, when you ask somebody to point to the sky, they'll just point straight out because it's there, it's everywhere. So at night, when all the birds have gone to bed, when the sun has set and when everything is all quieting down, and the stars start to reveal themselves, then is when it brings in this sense of sort of theatre, sense of awe, that there is the night sky, and there it is in all its glory and all its beauty. And yet, there are all the people doing all their things around it, be it in farmers still going about their daily or nightly, we'd say, looking, tending to their sheep, or cars travelling to and forth. So all this is going on with the backdrop of the stars there. And maybe we've kind of lost that sense of wonder and sense of awe when it comes to seeing something that's actually there all the time in front of us.
Brian has a simple but effective approach to his craft. The night begins with a run through of equipment and supplies. Technological advances make things easier, but the images he captures don't require a massive financial investment.
Basically, it's an entry-level DSLR, and there's nothing special about it. It's not specifically for astrophotography. It's the normal camera that you'd use for going out taking pictures of your family, going out taking landscape pictures. And this, I suppose, just shows that you don't have to have the most expensive equipment.
Low levels of light pollution in these parts means it's relatively easy to pick a location. Then, all you need is patience.
It's sort of a combination of trying to find the right time and to know the right time. And one of the things that I've often found is that you have to be in the right mood for doing something like photographing the night sky. So there's a lot of aspects and a lot of things that sort of come together to make up an image, and patience is probably the most part.
While his photographs capture objects that are light years away, the local landscape is central to Brian's approach.
It's trying to capture a sense of wonder and a sense of awe, but at the same time trying to put it into perspective. So taking a photograph of the night sky with the landscape in the foreground, that people will recognize and say, what stars are these around it? Is that one of the constellations? Is it the Plough? Is it Orion? Is it whatever? It's one of these things where you sort of awaken a sense of wonder in people when they see an image like that.
The impact of a back injury this year means Brian has a little more time to give to photography. He recently selected 20 images for an exhibition that's running at the Eris Art Centre in Belmullet. Shot over a number of months around North Mayo, the pictures reveal the amazing sights that surround us.
Does it get overwhelming anytime?
Yeah, it can, and sometimes I'll walk away from the camera. I'll just leave the camera alone and just enjoy it. People sometimes get so caught up with their phones trying to record stuff and that they don't actually experience it. And sometimes with the camera, I'll feel that way and I'll just walk away and I'll stand and I'll just look in wonder and awe and go, wow, I'm part of this. This is part of what's going on. I'm part of the universe. This is all, you know, way too much to be just kind of standing behind the camera. Did I get it right? Did I not? You have to become part of it as well. And that's the whole reason around sort of trying to capture these images, is to give other people a sense of wonder, a sense of awe that's out there, that anyone can achieve.
And there you have wonderful images of the night sky taken here in Ireland. After the break, we have more stories from Science Week as we head to Birr in County Offaly and one of the oldest telescopes in Ireland. We'll see you shortly. Welcome back to Nationwide, where all this week we're being encouraged to take a look at the science and the world around us and beyond. Our next story takes us to County Offaly, where scientists are monitoring the solar flares that create the aurora borealis. Niall Martin reports.
Birr County Offaly, a genteel town with echoes of a grand Georgian past. You wouldn't think that Birr Castle was a sort of NASA of its day, though. In the castle grounds, the 3rd Earl of Ross built the largest telescope in the world, the 72-inch Leviathan telescope.
This Leviathan telescope behind me, I think, is one of the most amazing objects that we have in Ireland. This telescope was a difficult telescope to build. It required a lot of money. It was during the famine that they started building it, then they stopped building it during the height of the famine, and then afterwards the scientific discoveries came. It resolved the structure of galaxies for the first time. No other human being had seen that galaxies have a spiral shape. So an Irish man here in County Offaly built that telescope to go and look at these things and found these galaxies have little spiral arms in them. So that was just an amazing discovery.
These days, there's a modern high-tech observatory based in Birr Castle grounds.
This is a TV aerial over there for picking up TV waves, radio waves normally, but we point it at the sun and we pick up the radio waves coming from the sun, and then we do some interesting physics with that, and that's where the kind of high-tech comes in.
And another thing there, that particular antenna, it's none of your fancy stuff.
It's not, that's called the B&Q antenna. So the B&Q antenna was put together by some undergraduates actually as their final year project. So one of them happened to be a physicist and very good at woodwork, and he was able to actually put that together. So it's very simple, very low-tech kind of stuff, but you know, the students learn an awful lot about how to build things with their own hands. You know, they learn an awful lot by doing that. In fact, I learn an awful lot by building these kind of antennas ourselves.
And what these aerials are picking up now are radio waves coming from sun flares. The analysing equipment is located in the Ross Observatory. Trinity academics work away in here in what was once a cow and sheep shed.
Welcome to the Ross Solar Terrestrial Observatory, or used to be called the Sheep Shed Control Room, but in you come. Well, as you can see, this is a bit of a contrast between what you saw outside. Here we have all our computers, and they're taking data from all of the instruments that we saw outside in the yard, and what they're showing us is all of these explosions happening on the sun, or we're waiting for the explosions to happen on the sun. And then once they go off, I get an automatic warning. In fact, it comes to my email and to my mobile phone and tells me that a solar flare has just happened. So this is a beautiful picture of the sun taken by a NASA spacecraft called the Solar Dynamics Observatory, and it shows all of these hot gas that comes from the sun. This big blob down here shows a solar flare, and it's one of these solar flares that produces all of the energy that can cause the northern lights. And we've seen some of these beautiful pictures earlier on from County Mayo showing the glimmering northern lights out across the Atlantic.
But work has now begun on the big one, a radio telescope called LOFAR, which will be part of an existing trans-European network of radio telescopes.
LOFAR is going to look at lots of different things. For me, it's going to look at the sun, and I'm going to understand these solar explosions. But it'll look at more exotic stars as well. And one of the most exciting areas, I think, are black holes. And so I've got some lovely pictures of a black hole here and what LOFAR sees. So this picture here, I mean, it's just awesome, really. You know, to think about the scales of this is amazing. This here is what looks like a normal star. You know, this is what an optical telescope, what your eye would actually see if you looked up at the night sky. So this is just one star. And it doesn't look like there's anything around it. But when we get the LOFAR telescope from other countries around Europe, this is what we see. So we can see that the star actually has a big envelope of gas around it. And this gas isn't just sitting there static in space. It's actually being ejected from the black hole and filling this whole volume of space with this hot gas. And LOFAR can see this. Which you can build the biggest telescope that you want at optical wavelengths. You will never see that. LOFAR sees that. It sees the radio glow coming off this hot gas.
Outside, the groundworks are being laid for the aerial array that will take in signals from space.
So, well, this is the weatherlock field, and this is where the sheep were grazing up until about 6 months ago. And now, as you can see, we've got the diggers in, and they're beginning to build the platforms for the LOFAR radio telescope. So we have wonderful support from the Earl and the Countess of Ross, who own Burr Castle and this area, and they donated land to us for 35 years, 6 acres of land to build this radio telescope to reignite astronomy in Burr again. And of course, we also had great support from the local community. Some of the school kids raised 750 euros for the project. We also had the Lions Club, the Chamber of Commerce also supported us. So there's huge buy-in from not only Burr, but also actually Offaly County as well. 14 articulated trucks are going to arrive in April, and then on the back of those will be the antennas and all the electronics and the cabling. And then a team of myself and the other universities and some undergraduates are going to come in here and install all the antennas and all of the electronics, and then we'll turn the switch hopefully in August 2017.
Who's paying for all this?
Well, who's paying for all of this? It's taken 5 years to raise all the money for this. The first investors, actually, in this, the first supporters, were two people, Dennis O'Brien and Dermot Desmond, were the first to put money forward to this. They contributed 100,000 euros. And then we also had just a wonderful man called Joe Hogan, who's the founder and CTO of a company called OpenNet. And he has helped us fundraise all along the way to get to this point. But the main supporters of it are the Government Science Foundation Ireland, and they're responsible for investing in grand scientific experiments for Ireland.
But it's not all about the big stuff. With LOFAR comes the sort of ultra-high-speed broadband that will put a smile on teenage faces in Burr.
The hope is then we'll have the radio telescope operational next year. We're going to have an education centre as well, where people can come and learn about how the telescope operates, what kind of science can be done. But when you come to Burr Castle, you can also learn about the cutting edge that we have here, but also the past tradition that Ireland has also had in astronomy with the Leviathan telescope.
Interesting plans there in Burr. A reminder that this is Science Week, and there are events up and down the country all week, including a science festival here in Cork. For more information on those events, go to the website which is on your screens now. And so we've come to the end of this evening's Nationwide. We'll see you shortly, but don't forget to take the time, if you have it, to look around at the stars. On next Wednesday's Nationwide, the English town that welcomes horse breeders and buyers from around the world, including many Irish. We are in Newmarket to see the Irish who earn a living in the bloodstock industry in this part of the UK.